ahead of time. Our next session, very, very interesting. I think a hotbed of, not litigation so far, but hotbed of interpretation issues, place of supply for goods, services, and bundled supplies. And, the esteemed panelists, starting with the moderator, Amit Sarkar, BDO, senior advocate, Mr. N. Venkatraman, a big hand for him, please. Mr. P.V. Srinivasan, corporate advisor. Shivdas from Lakshmi Kumaran and Sridharan. I'll quickly introduce our moderator for the session, Amit Sarkar. He's a partner and head indirect tax at BDO. Amit leads the indirect tax practice. Prior to joining BDO, he was a partner with the Grant Thornton's indirect tax practice for 4 years. He's led several assignments in his 18-year career, including tax-efficient supply chain management space, India entry assignments for companies in diverse sectors like ATM manufacturing, insurance, banking, telecommunications, auto. He's also actively involved in GST policy formulation and advocacy with policymakers representing various industry associations and chambers. Mr. Shivdas is a principal partner, Bangalore, at Lakshmi Kumaran and Sridharan. And as I said, a special mention of Venkat sir, he's flown in only for this session, one of the most prolific tax lawyers in the country. An interesting assignment for you all, if you all ever want to do it, or I'll give the result. If you do a search on who's argued the maximum number of tax cases in the last 12 months in the High Court and the Supreme Court, that'll be him. Just phenomenal. Every day when I call him, he's in a different High Court. So he'll bring a counsel perspective to the entire discussion. Mr. D.P. Nagendra Kumar, Principal Commissioner for Customs and for Service Tax and Excise. He should be joining us in the next 5 minutes or so. We'll wait for him. But in the meantime, we'll start off. Amit, all yours.
Thank you so much, Arun. Morning, everyone. Kickstarting the second session, which probably will be defining what really GST will be all about from an administration and compliance perspective. And I think the best way to start off is to hand over the floor to Venkat sir to probably give us some guiding principles on what really was the jurisprudence behind identifying the place of supply rules for goods, services and bundled supplies. Hopefully that will warm up your thoughts as well and will give a context to the questions that we will be debating in the course of this session. Over to you, sir.
Tax teacher and guru, international taxation, PBS, and ladies and gentlemen. See, why do we need this place of supply rules? That's the core of this whole law. Let's go back to an era prior to 1956. See, when Constitution was conceived, states had the eminent power to tax sale of goods, only states. Union never had the power till the 6th Constitutional Amendment. So 50 to 56, every transaction of sale can be taxed only by states. So what happened when transactions took place cross-border between states? State A will sell, Karnataka will sell to Andhra. So seller is Karnataka, buyer is Andhra. Head office Bombay, bank accounts say in Chennai, and the buyer and seller chose to sign the contract in a hill station in Mount Abu, Rajasthan. So which state had the domain competence to tax? That was the issue. So first constitutional bench in United Motors held states which had in any sort of a control over the transaction is entitled to tax the transaction. That's how it sounded. Therefore, it permitted every state to say, I had one limb of the commercial activity in my state. Contract was signed here, Rajasthan had power. Money was credited in Chennai, Madras had power. Buyer or seller, both can tax. So, same transaction resulted in multiple taxation. So, within 7 months, this 5-judge bench judgment was referred to 7 judges, which became the famous Bengal immunity case. And Bengal immunity, uttered the first sound of caution. It said, look here, this is opening the Pandora box, because commercial transactions have multiple limbs. You can't be allowing every state to tax because it has one of the limbs falling in its, within its competence. So it ruled, it is suggested that cross-border transactions should be taxed only by parliament and not by the states. Therefore, entry 54, list 2 got amended. Sixth constitutional amendment took the power of taxation of interstate trade out of the states and put it as 92 capital A, list 1 in the union schedule, list 1 of the 7th schedule, and thus resulted in the birth of the Central Sales Tax Act, 1956. That's the origin. Now, what did Central Sales Tax Act do? It has to choose, some state has to tax it. So out of all the commercial limbs, it limited to movement. Originating state from where goods moved will be the state competent to tax a transaction. So all your place of supply is not a nightmare. It all started somewhere like this. You need, so the simple point is this. When you have multiple jurisdiction involving multiple commercial activity or activity spread over different territories, you need to identify who is competent to tax. Now, what is the problem today? It all confined to movement in Section 3 of 1956 Act. It was only dealing with goods and that to interstate. Today, states and the unions have come together. So it's a beautiful law. It is not a law falling under the concurrent list, as many people assume under the Constitution. No. Concurrent means both can levy, both can tax, and if there is an inconsistency, the power of the state should yield to the power of the center. This is not a concurrent levy. You will not find GST in any of the three schedules. The schedule itself is part of the constitutional provision, 246 capital A. It says what is the levy and who will levy. It is a simultaneous levy, not a concurrent levy by both the union and the states. So it is both states and union can tax the transaction. Now it's a combination of goods, combination of service, combination of states and the union. So when you have this mixture, how do you draw the jurisdiction to tax? So we had a preliminary run over it under the service tax provision. You had the point of taxation rules. That has now become the time rules under the IGST. Similarly, you had the place of provision of service rules. That has become the place of supply rules with a broader perspective and a package here and there. So this is the historical evolution of the place of supply rules. Don't think that it was in Europe and therefore we borrowed it. Yeah, it's there in other countries, no doubt about it. But the reason being this, multiple jurisdiction taxation requires identification of a transactional element for taxation purposes. That's the moral. So now with this base, we will now see there are a lot of contours and it does throw up a lot of doubts. It does throw a lot of conflicts. And even today, there are many areas where it can result in multiple taxation. So how do we read these ground rules? What are the sutras in this, which as a trade you can follow? We will try to decipher a few for you to the best of our ability, subject, of course, to the caveat class. It's all subject to changes. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so very much. These guiding principles... So nicely summarized by you, actually now provides the foundation for all of us to warm up to the complex discussion of place of supply rules under GST. At stake is the government's fundamental promise that with GST coming in, we are truly looking at a common market inside India. So let's now go ahead and discuss certain specific situations and see whether the government's promise of one nation, one market under GST really is coming true or not. Remember, we are discussing place of supply rules, but this is the foundation on which many of the other discussion points under GST is at stake. How do you claim credits? How do you value transactions? And so on and so forth. With this as a background, I will now possibly bring in PVS sir into the discussion on something which is maybe a question that is there amongst everybody who's trying to implement GST, which is the infamous bill to ship to conundrum. So the case is, I am a supplier who's been contracted by a customer who has a central procurement function. I am in Bangalore. The central procurement office is also in Bangalore. The request from my client is that I should bill him to his office in Bangalore, but the goods should be shipped, say, to Chennai. What should be the place of supply interpretation in your opinion, okay, in this kind of a case study? And please do extend it to other variations if you feel relevant. Please, sir.
It doesn't fit into the legal provisions which are so far prescribed. So it requires some amount of interpretation. Only reason it doesn't fit it is that the law has dealt with three parties. Supplier being a person, the third person being a person, and the recipient being a person. That kind of a situation of bill to ship to has been dealt with. So it's an agency relationship form. The agency also a person that has been dealt with. So in that kind of a scenario, it says that the invoicing will have to be first on the agent, they let the credit chain pass on to the agent, and the agent in turn possibly will pass on to the end supplier. That triangle has been completed in law. But when there is no third person, but there are distinct persons, the head office, which procurement office, central procurement office, which organizes the purchase, gets the invoice, but the delivery of goods happens to other branches of the same entity, this particular situation has not been dealt with in law. Two things can happen. You can say that third person is still to be defined, but still is a separate person as understood under law. So it cannot fall into that definition. Another way is to say third person could be a distinct person too. Possibly a clarification needs to come that third person would include a distinct person too. Till then, I presume on the basis that the entire credit chain is to break three triangles. If triangles have to be broken, then the interpretation for a third person will possibly be applied to distinct person also. And that's the way I would proceed on the basis that let the central procurement office pick up the entire credit and put it back to the states where the goods have been consumed or supplied at a later point in time. There are two supplies certainly in this, like in a triangle. So the first supply is from the supplier to the central procurement office, and the next supply is from the procurement office to the destination states where the goods finally reach. So I will possibly interpose the 10(1)(b) clause into this to ensure that it's a triangle supply, and the same inference should be drawn for that. That's my interpretation, not necessarily that I'm right.
No, that's fine. So your thoughts?
Yeah. We'll go to the basic jurisprudence. Under the GST scenario, you are high C sales, sale in the course of import, and transit sale are taxable. They are not exempt anymore. That's the first sutra. Not exempt. Because first two is treated as an IGST under the import, and transit sale, as PVS rightly puts it, under 10B1, a third person is identified and he is the buyer. Now, why have they done it? Because it's a value-added tax. Karnataka sells it to Andhra, supplies it to Tamil Nadu. It wants first Karnataka-Andhra a transaction, and Andhra's commercial invoice on Chennai to be the second transaction, so that the value chain is maintained. That's why this positive insertion, no more transit sale, no more E1, C1 form, it's possible. This is the basis. Now the second fundamental is, now what happens if it is three party, fine. Law is very clear. But A, the head office, places an order on B. A from Karnataka places an order on Bombay to be supplied to its warehouse or factory in, say, Andhra. Now, will this rule apply? Should head office be the first buyer, and should it re-invoice the factory because it says establishments means distinct persons? Now, technically or legally, there are two things which we can still follow and to our support. A, the language used is third person and not distinct person, which is what PVS was also trying to highlight. So whether a distinct person will include a third person, according to me, it will not, because different expressions needs to be interpreted with a different intent. That's the basic foundation of law. But the second reason can be more valid is the so-called assumption of a distinct person. This deeming fiction operates only between the branch and the head office, not for a third party, qua, in terms of a supply. Between them, they are distinct person. But when it involves a third party to transact, they don't become a third person under 10(1)(b). And therefore, you need not have to follow this a prescription. You can still pass your credit under the ISD mode or a cross charge as whichever facility you can follow. You may not fall into the trap of 10(1)(b). Is one possible view from my end.
So your thoughts, Shishidasan?
One is, as PVS is pointing out, the expression third person obviously will not cover a distinct person. Third person means has to be completely separate from the entity which is supplying. Therefore, a third person has to be a different person, not a distinct person. And distinct person has a very specific connotation in the GST law. It has to be establishments of the same entity. Therefore, to apply the bill to ship to principle which they have embodied here for a situation of operations between the establishments of one entity may not be possible.
So are you saying that therefore you have a situation in the example I gave that for the supplier in Karnataka, he has to understand that he's supplying to a legal entity, shipment location being Chennai.
That's right.
So I take the principles of Section 3 of CST Act applied in the world of GST by looking at and respecting 10(1)(a) instead of 10(1)(b).
Yes.
By reasonably interpreting the meaning of the word supplier, recipient and person to be qua legal entities and not qua registered locations.
In contradistinction to a third person.
In contradistinction to a third person. And the reason why we are taking that consensus view possibly, okay, with a thought on the fact that a clarification may still be required. But we are taking that view because even if you look at 10(1)(b), 10(1)(b) actually looks at a three-party situation. So 10(1)(b), as sir was mentioning rightfully so, is actually killing the principles of in-transit sales and bringing in this point that there are three parties involved and there is value addition happening between the intermediary party as well. So if I now bring in a second example, that there is a person A who is engaged person B to supply something to person C, right? So B will first bill A and then A will bill C. But this is under the principle of legal entities.
That's right.
And therefore you'll come under 10(1)(b), but under 10(1)(a), you will still take this as a ship to location as an identification.
I have only one caution to make. We have looked at the delivery aspect of it, place of supply has been determined. Still the invoice is to Bangalore, the central procurement
yes.
office. The credit would possibly flow to Bangalore. No, it has not gone to the factories. No, I have to find a mechanism to distribute the credit. And ISD is not a mechanism because we are dealing with goods here and not with services. So I need an outward supply in some way. So how do I distribute? That means there are two options which are available. One, not to have a central procurement function at all for bill to supply of the category we have got. That means no organization can procure centrally. It has to necessarily procure at the factories. Or the supplier has to be told to cannibalize the invoices and issue separate invoices for the value of those supplies. Now bulk pricing has lost the system. That means there's a commercial disadvantage which will be entered into. Because if I have said supply annual requirement of say 1,000 computers, no matter when I'm going to take it, this is the price for you. Now each of the supplies will have to be cannibalized and supplied. That means the price at that point has to be determined. So that's a difficulty in pricing.
What he says, I think we should take this point with a lot of care. See, I understand, and maybe the solution lies here. You will get the credit in Karnataka, and the goods will reach, say, Tamil Nadu. So you can't do an ISD if it is goods. You can do it if it is services. So what do? See, one method which we also thought day before yesterday when we were speaking in Hyderabad, we should align ourselves with the law. Is it possible that the head office does only an MSA? The POs should originate from the respective locations. Head office can still pay, it doesn't matter. So they can't say merely because Karnataka head office paid the bill, the credit, Karnataka should not claim that everything should come only to Karnataka. That may not be right. So have like you do in your cross-border transaction globally, the parent entity enters into an MSA, but the purchase orders flow from between the contracting entities. whether that arrangement will work. The reason being, see, one sutra you should bear it in mind in GST law. This is a law involving states too, along with the union. Please have, this is a mantra, you should ingrain it in your heart and in your mind. States are equal federal partners in this job. Each state is a federal partner with the union. Union Tamil Nadu, Union Andhra, Union Karnataka. That's how it's going to work. So states will demand its share at any cost. It's the second point. Therefore, commercial operations happening in a particular state, origination of the transactional activities, it is advisable to commence from that state. So that the confusion of whether here or there can be considerably avoided. Cost compliance, all these things matters, I don't deny that. But it is much safer to protect your credit rather than getting into a loop, into a cycle. So solution to the doubt raised by PVS is, have an MSA so that price is beaten up well, everything is negotiated. But individual purchase orders should be raised by the respective locations so that it facilitates the mode of taking the credit. That's something which you can possibly work it out.
Just to add to what Venkat says, we should also be clear that between the central administration and the state administrations, to be fair, central administrations are much more mature than the state administrations. And therefore, if you are exposing yourself to a situation where the state authorities are going to look at your transactions, you should be clear, you should try to pay more of taxes within the states, takes credit there, rather than trying to go for central taxes. That is going to be, we are seeing it in VAT. What is the problem in VAT today? Most of the VAT schedules apply the HSN schedules. But have you come across any situation where a state authority looks at the HSN schedule the same way a central authority looks at? You don't. Right? Therefore, that is going to be a biggest challenge. Therefore, attempt should more to focus on paying taxes within the state, taking credits, rather than a central tax. That should be the attempt. Inevitably, it happens the other way around. That's a different situation.
I am actually foreseeing a problem like the local police versus CBI.
Well, if we take this view, now let me bring in the world of services in this. I have a All India annual maintenance contract that I'm signing.
I think somebody has a question there or something.
Sure. Is there a question coming up?
There are two mechanisms. We have a more or less 20 odd minutes at the end for a question.
I think we should take the questions together so towards
time,
the end.
That time, maybe some of the issues get clarified by then also. Yeah.
He's keen that he should ask now only. So let's ask him.
Sure. Let's just get a mic to him, please.
Yeah, my name is Krishna. I am a tax consultant. This is based on my experience of dealing with the EU VAT, a similar kind of a situation. While you talked about a domestic transaction between two different states, take a case of an international tax action where I enter into an MSA with an overseas entity. Let's take, for example, a Microsoft or Amazon, and I do the supply of services, or I do the services for them. Let's take an IT implementation. I do the implementation in India, but the contract has come from an overseas entity. And that contract invariably under their business model is centrally controlled out of the overseas entity. So under these circumstances, will it be exempt because it's an export of services? Let us assume it is only I export services to Microsoft to be implemented outside India, then it is exempt. But I've got a global contract for them that I implement this in 50 different locations, of which India is one of the locations. I raise my invoice on the overseas entity, okay, because that is what the contract is for all the implementation that I do, but I do the implementation here. So under these circumstances, I do not know whether the tax authorities have the maturity to understand this, because they may consider this to be an evasion of tax because I'm raising an invoice overseas. That is one issue. The second issue that you touched upon during the discussions is about how do you structure the contract, an MSA and a PO. Today, what is that happening is, today you're forcing enterprises to change their systems to a large extent saying that because you have introduced something called as a GST, they want to change their systems. Globally, if you see, there are three systems in which different enterprises work. Some enterprises have an allocation, which is a budgetary allocation. So they have a budgetary allocation which is centrally controlled. So they provide all the resources and the money for that, and then they control, but it is delivered to various locations. The second model is that they enter into a contract, as Mr. Venkatraman said, but then the POs come from the local entities. And the third model is something that where they, the local entities themselves negotiate. Today, because of GST, we can't force any enterprise to change their model. You have three different models to that extent, so that will be an issue. But more important, I suspect, will be the issues where you have an international contract with a domestic implementation, where a raise an invoice on the overseas entity. It will be useful to address this issue. I'm raising this now basically because you talked about it, so it has got the context to that extent. There's one more question that I will ask a little later.
Sure, sure. Thanks so much, and I think this is a question which I would pass on to PVS sir to give his thoughts.
Krishnan's question deals with services, so to that extent is that for services, particularly though this falls into non-specified services, so there is no specific rule, so the general rule will apply. It is the contracting party which is the one which we have to look at. The law uses the word registered, but since for international rules are separate, there you don't need a registration, so it will be an export out of India. Obviously, the consideration will be realized in convertible foreign exchange, I presume. Even though the physical performance of services taking place within India and within states for that matter, the location or the place of supply services rules as notified so far, it gives an indication that it is Microsoft US to which I have made the supply, and Microsoft is obligated to make that, is the recipient there. It's an obligation to pay for those services, and I'm realizing convertible foreign exchange. It would be an export of services, according to me. I know this issue emanated in some kind of a sales commission or billing commission model, even under the service tax, because you have back-to-back supplies, you contract, you render selling marketing services in India, but the contracting party is outside India. The rules were tweaked from time to time. From 2010 or something, it changed to say that the services, if they are performed in India, then it's a performance of services being in India. They altered the rules. A specific rule was brought about to bring about performance into the category. Here, performance is not the category, it's the recipient, which is the classification. Therefore,
if I may possibly look at the entire chain of transactions in the example you mentioned, let's say
the second leg is not addressed by him.
Sorry?
The second leg.
Let's first finish the first leg, and then we come to the second leg. Otherwise, we'll fall down, right? So, to continue the conversation that you had mentioned, if I'm interpreting the supply to be an export, because the contracting party is the party, and it is also defined in the definition of recipient, that the recipient is the person who is actually going to make the payment for the service rendered. So, your entire $100 of work performed in India is being paid by, let's say, Amazon in Ireland. Okay, so Amazon obviously becomes an exporting party as far as I'm concerned. I get the benefit of zero rating in India. Amazon, in turn, looking at the principle of UAT, will start allocating that amount to whichever other beneficiary locations, including India. At the point of time that Amazon is allocating an amount to legal entity subsidiary in India, under IGST reverse charge, that amount of money has to be paid by India. So therefore, India gets its fair share of tax through the round-tripping mechanism. Similarly, in Europe, this is going to be an import of service if it's an export from India. And therefore, in Europe, in Ireland, Amazon will have to pay European Union VAT or Irish VAT under reverse charge. And when they in turn are doing an intra-EU allocation of spends, they will end up getting the benefit of zero rating, and this amount can be utilized against other output liabilities. So it's a harmonious interpretation of place of supply rules, not just of India jurisdiction, but of multiple jurisdictions. If we start by accepting that there is a distinction between recipient and beneficiary in the example that you're mentioning.
Yeah, that is correct.
I want to utter only one caution under the GST mode. Paul Merchant, to my knowledge, judgment has not been implemented as on date today anywhere in any part of the country. Because we are fighting a lot of cases in courts saying enforce Paul Merchant. At least now the provision says 90% of refund should be given to you. All right. See, in both the scenarios discussed by them, as long as the beneficiary is a third party to the foreign supplier, no problem. You will succeed in proving it's an export. If the beneficiary is going to be a subsidiary of the principal, then don't risk. You can still succeed is different, but you will have to engage all of us to defend till the cows return. So it's, after all, you can take credit. So we have to be prudent hereafter. I'm answering your second question straight away. In a GST scenario, commercial prudence plays a very, very vital role rather than jurisprudence. You have to blend both and come to a, you must know to harmonize it. Tailor make it to your own size of your leg, foot. So this is very important exercise you have to do. Now, to your question, should you have to change your model? The whole world changed their models because of transfer pricing regulation. So you need to make an overall at this point of time so that you align with the system. You can't change the system. You have to align yourself with the system. You must be very clear, barely because the system is monstrous at this point of time visibly. You can't therefore condemn it. You can't. It's going to stay. So how best you can align and how best you can make that monster tame it into your domestic animal. That's the exercise which each one of you have to prepare yourself technically and in your thought process, and it is achievable. It is achievable. People have achieved it in transfer pricing, are achieving it in transfer pricing. So GST is one more exercise like that.
Yes, sir. You had to.
In fact, we should be slightly be fair even to the department, the government, as far as this rule is concerned. If you see this controversy which Venkat was talking about, Paul Merchants and Microsoft and all that controversies, the department always used to take a stand that the beneficiary is here and therefore there is not an export, it is an activity done locally. But if you see the circulars issued by the department from time to time, they never agreed with this interpretation. A 2009 circular or a 2010 amendment, all of them successively said that we will consider this to be an export, either by way of an amendment or by way of a circular. And when they made the GST law, they have specifically not put it as part of the prescribed services, but it comes under the default rule. So you go by either the location of the registered person, or the person is not registered, location of the person. So to that extent, I think we should be fair to credit the government that they have tried to maintain a consistency in it. It's a different point that the officers down the line do not accept either of these decisions. That's a different point. But I think over a period, last 2 years or 3 years, I could see, they are indeed accepting Paul Merchants, Microsoft, and trying to give refunds. So to that extent, I think they have tried to solve the problem. After solving this problem, even after doing this, we still feel that they should adjust completely to our business requirements. I think there's a disconnect.
You had one more question which you mentioned?
No, part B has been answered differently by the senior counsel, saying that you amend your ways.
Right. So let's take another situation to continue our journey on interpreting places supply rules. And as I was about to start off, let's take services. Let's take an annual maintenance contract, okay, which is a pure service contract. This is not going to have any kind of pollution by way of goods getting supplied as part of the maintenance activity. Let's leave that part aside for a moment. Pure labor, pure service contract. Typically, annual maintenance contracts also have a situation where you have several beneficiary locations, but the contracting entity location will be the head office or the regional office, as the case might be. I'm taking a page from what Venkat sir had mentioned in terms of, should you have an MSA and then a PO raised? Now, you cannot be bringing that principle down to an AMC activity, because the AMC activity by definition means the work has started. And the contracting party, again in my example, is, let's say, in Karnataka. The AMC service provider is also in Karnataka, and they are covering, let's say, computer maintenance for all the offices which is located in many states in India. In this particular case, how will you interpret place of supply rules? Will you go by the point of the recipient being the person making the payment and there infer person being the registered location? Sir, would you like to start off?
I would possibly, in AMC situation, I have thought of two solutions, both for goods and services. I'm not saying they are the only valid ones. There can be counter views. In AMC, at the point of contracting, when you collect the consideration or entitled to the consideration, there's a supply in itself. That supply you determine between the contracting party, the two parties, wherever they are, Karnataka, Bombay for a moment. That contract, that consideration is over, that IGST transaction is complete. then that's an actual performance of service. The actual performance of service can happen in two ways. Suppose the failure tomorrow happens in Madhya Pradesh, Bhopal, and you have to attend through labor contract. You may deploy your labor or you can hire a labor. If you are hiring a labor, you will pay for that labor. And therefore, that transaction also gets completed because you have one more payment cycle and you will get it completed. Suppose you deploy your own labor and you don't have any establishment in Madhya Pradesh for a moment. Possibly, there is no supply within Madhya Pradesh because you have not met the standards of fixed establishment within Madhya Pradesh. You have got human capital, but there's no permanence about it. So therefore, it will be a supply of labor for a temporary zone. It does not create a fixed establishment. So in that case, I would think there won't be any supply at that point. The original contract has been serviced. There's no other consideration emanating, and therefore the law remains as it is. There's no supply after the first contract. So we can have in two situations that you have an establishment in Bhopal, you employ a third party to perform the services, or you deploy somebody from the head office to perform the service, say in Karnataka, in Bhopal. Three situations are possible. If I employ a third party to perform the service, there's a consideration flowing, there's a supply, that will be treated as a separate supply. If you have an establishment in Madhya Pradesh and therefore engage that establishment, the transaction between distinct persons gets triggered, there's one more supply between the Karnataka and Madhya Pradesh, that supply will have to be recognized. If you don't employ either of these two, and you deploy some labor from Karnataka to attend to that labor issue, I think you don't meet the standard of fixed establishment also, and therefore there is no supply at that point in time. This is my view. I may be wrong, but this is the way I have constructed the solution.
In fact, I will borrow straight away these 3 points. But the question Amit posed to us, the initial contract, I mean, that's something which can create the confusion. If you have one contract, whether it's IGST or a local contract, it's fine. What should be the recommendation for a user of the service who is located, see, his AMC contracts of computer, suppose he's a bank, it's licensed across the country, and the head office of the bank is, say, in Bangalore. So service provider is PVS. Is it advisable for the bank to enter into one contract through the head office with PVS? Or it should do the MSA POO even for a service? See, one ground rule you must have it in mind, which Shivadas hinted 10 minutes back. Try to avoid an IGST as far as possible, because every potential IGST will be a potential SGST transaction in future. The maximum litigation is going to come only from two areas: questioning IGST as a SGST. And all of us, for the past 15 years, we did not earn a copper out of classification because there was a single rate. Now you have multiple rates from 0 to 28, especially service and goods. So there's going to be a lot of confusion on classification in case. These are the two potential areas which you should bear it in mind. So even for service, it takes time, I do agree, and it's so easy to say and very difficult to do in terms of cost compliance, managing everything. But cut down as much as possible your transactions being non-IGST. It's a recommendation. To what extent is possible depends on the nature of business you do. If you're going to have a centralized PO and a centralized, your distribution can come to a collateral attack, especially in the situation which he says. Sometimes you will hire, sometimes you may not hire. Sometimes you may hire a third party and pay him from your branch may pay, even though PO may be ultimately serviced from the head office. These limbs cannot stand the test of law in a court to say, therefore action point was this, and therefore this is the place of supply. Courts are not going to accept it. Courts will go by simple mechanism, simple common sense, non-complicated identification. Please understand. So your business resolution should be less complex. Only then, if there is a litigation, court will support you. That's one caution. And every high court, up to high court, whatever we may say, democratic, union, one, up to high court, ultimately it's regional centric. So the default rule will be SGST, and then it becomes IGST. Be careful about it. These are all future cautions. Don't mistake. When you plan, these are all the foundations you should follow. Plan it properly at one stroke so that you have less problems in the future.
If I can give my comment on this.
Advance is paid for such a kind of a transaction.
I'm coming to that as well. Let's first identify the principles of what will be the tax. Then we can figure out what happens on advances. I think would be a better way to answer this. I have a slightly supplementary view to this. If I am getting into an All India AMC, and I am now putting forward a hypothesis, and let's discuss that. The service provider is in Bangalore. The contracting entity head office is also in Bangalore. I, as the service provider, respecting Venkat sir's mantra, will stand up and infer that this is a local supply for mine. And therefore, I will charge dual GST on the bill. Now, the entire All India performance of work is not my botheration, because I'm literally interpreting the definition of recipient to be the person who's making a payment to me. Who's the person making the payment to me? My customer legal entity, okay? Which is the location making the payment to me? It is the location Bangalore. And therefore, I'm happily going to raise my service invoice to the head office in Bangalore. Now, I have in the books of the customer two options available with me. Option one is,
Oh, you have come at a time when we are still worrying about the whole thing, sir.
Such an enlightened panel, I don't have to worry about the clarity in at least clarification, whatever you
want. Right, so we have Nagendraji have already joined us. Thank you so much for coming, sir. I'll just probably complete my point. So I'm saying now, after having done a local billing as supplier to the recipient, now I'm in the books of the recipient, because the recipient has actually contracted on behalf of itself as a distinct person and also all its locations across India as distinct persons. I have two options. Either I can say that the head office is therefore doing a branch transfer of services and therefore go ahead through a cost allocation mechanism and charge IGST on the allocation of monies to the recipient locations, or I have the ISD route by which I can allocate the credits I have earned of CGST and SGST in transferring those credits to those location branches. If I do that, am I correct? This is my hypothesis.
You are not wrong.
But am I right?
As I said, see, the only difference between goods and services, in service you have the ISD mechanism that supports you to transfer. But will states be happy receiving a transferred credit or realized money? That's the question we need to bear it in mind as a trader, as a businessman. So taking a credit into its state, will state be happy when the economic activity happens there? See, it's something like BEPS. If your value addition happens in a particular state, it is better the transaction terminates in that state. How feasible it is based on your business, I can't say. It's 0 to 100. But if you can approximate it closer to that solution, your problems are less complex. Otherwise, you have all this mechanism. But should disputes, right? See, once you go under ISD or under a cross charge, valuation is a perennial issue. And they are going to now say, if they are distinct persons, that's the problem which we are debating. Once it is considered to be a distinct person, you're going to have the same issues which is throbbing in transfer pricing on cross-border. Each state will say its share will be more. It's not going to leave it. And what happens to unutilized credit there, where in your distribution mechanism, in terms of your allocation of costs, one state will have lesser work, another state will have more work. There will be a penetrative tendency to push it there, when your realistic cost allocation may not support it. So can, these are all the problem, minor, major, depending upon what you're going to face. So you have to choose between these two. Both are legally sustainable. But which is less harmful depends on the nature of business you do. Take a call based on that. If it is too complex, somebody was saying day before yesterday, I have 40,000 dealers, how do I do? You obviously cannot enter 40,000 contracts. So you have no choice but to go by the ISD. But you have only, say, 20 locations, have it as an individual contract. This is something which you have to take a call on your sense, is what I suggest. So it's a combination of both.
No, just to add to what Venkat is saying, even when, see, ISD mechanism is going to be new for the states. It's not going to be something which they are used to. Even when ISD was operating in the center, we had problems being raised by the department at the ISD jurisdiction, saying that we will not accept this credit, we will say that this credit is wrong. So many issues came up. Now, if you are going to translate it into a state looking at an ISD mechanism, then definitely there's going to be a resistance in seeing whether this credit is right. Why should you transfer this credit? Why you should not have done this transaction within the state? The tax could have come to me not through the ISD mechanism but as a direct payment to me. Why is this happening? So that is bound to be there. We'll have to be, to a larger extent, be careful in trying to adopt indirect mechanisms of movement of tax. But keep it to a direct movement of payment of tax so that it makes it easier.
Department
that we'll have to be clear.
Could I dare to ask Nagendra Kumar ji to also get into this discussion now? So we were debating a case where it's an AMC contract, it's a pure service contract, where the supplier is in Karnataka, the customer who's engaging the supplier is also in Karnataka, but this is an all India annual maintenance contract for, let's say, computer maintenance. And that the customer, he has offices across India, and the service provider is to maintain the computers across India. So the debate is whether this would be construed as a local supply in Karnataka because the supplier is contracting with the head office in Karnataka, or should we actually conclude that because there is the beneficiary location in every state, should we be looking at the AMC provider to split his invoices across all the states? Or is there a more harmonious interpretation that can be brought in?
Well, if you look at the provisions, what the GST Act contains with regard to place of supply, the AMC services have not been separately categorized.
Yeah.
So the default rule should apply.
Yeah.
Where the recipient is located. Now this issue with regard to whether the recipient should be the recipient who is actually putting into use the effective use and enjoyment concept or is the contractual recipient, I think we need to keep it in mind one thing, that insofar as the goods are concerned, the place of supply is along with the goods. When it comes to services, it's going to be a little more challenge. I agree with the panelists. But let us look at this little more carefully. If there is a credit gets transferred to the ISD route, and if that ISD credit has a component of SGST or for that matter CGST part of it, whenever such cross credit is utilized for payment of tax, the fund transfer between the government will happen, and that's very clear. The concern that whether a state government should get an upfront cash payment or should wait for a transaction happening in the business sense and gets the fund settled across the intergovernments, I would personally say that an ISD route is what the law provides for, and that's a clean solution. How a state VAT will view this later and to say that this actual effective use enjoyment happened, now don't look at exactly what happened with regard to our cross-border supplies, because we had brought in complex situations like intermediary service, we had deviated with regard to OLDAR, etc., etc. Our move in the place of supply is to ultimately find the consumption. And in services, I would put it that unless I consciously put it as a place of effective use and enjoyment, we should buy a contractual recipient. That's what I would put across. Because in respect of intangibles, following the actual delivery of the service, where physical effective use and enjoyment happens, you all know. In the existing service tax regime also, we have not effectively notified anything in terms of that residual rule, which said that the government can notify such of those services where effective use and enjoyment happen in a particular jurisdiction. If I was that much legally clear, I could have put that across there.
Right.
So we should give a fair try, because we have consciously not chose to bring Rule 9 into the place of supply rules in the GST law. We should give an effect. But yes, depending on the business model, you would take a call. AMC maintenance repair could have different versions. The original equipment manufacturer could have a channel partner.
Yeah.
You could transfer the supply of good for a future AMC supply could happen at a point from where closer to the customer point. Does the transfer in title in goods move, or it is only transacted on the same entity basis, like a stock transfer? All possible permutation combinations are there. I think PVC is aware that this issue we discussed at that point of time. Guidance notes are being contemplated by the government. The first one was the source legislation. You are all aware now today, it's there in your hand. The rules have been put in place. We don't have a place of supply rules separately, because whatever we could have contemplated in the rules, we have put in the source legislation itself in the IGST Act. Guidance note will come. There are committees formed by the government in the Srinagar meeting, consisting of both the center and the state VAT officials, will form part of working groups. The working groups will come with a guidance note and get it vetted by the policy wing, and thereafter it will be taken to the GST Council for its ratification. We are expecting this exercise to complete in about less than a month's time. So the guidance note will come with examples. If you may recollect our taxpayer education guide, which we have said, it gave some amount of clarity, though we had something which we went back, that's a different issue. But certainly that gave some sort of an amplification as to what a bare law or a rule said so, right? With more practical examples, illustrations, and real life business situations, we'll try to put across at least those which are not subject to more than one interpretation, we'd like to put across and give a clarity and finality to that issue. That's what I foresee.
Thank you so much, sir. You had to say something?
I think we stand guided by the discussion so far. I think that's adequate.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Having discussed, and these are basic rules, by the way. These are basic client situations or business situations that we've spoken about. We have not yet discussed any complexity so far. This is a very standard AMC contract or a standard build-to-ship-to contract that we've discussed so far. Now, Venkat sir is nudging me, saying, okay, let's warm up even further. Okay, let's discuss bundle supplies. Let's have a situation where I'm co-mingling supply of goods and services. And I will first start off by identifying what exactly would be the nature of this supply under the GST world. Okay, I have a supply installation testing commissioning contract, okay, where I have a value ascribed to each of the stages. But it's a common contract. Question, is this a composite supply? Is this a mixed supply? Is it a deemed service as a works contract? Sir, would you want to start off?
These litigations have been fathomed in the direct tax regime very well. Most international supplies under EPC, how to divide the material component and the labor component, whether the entire thing originates out of India, there's an income attribution, those are there. In my view, the way you have sounded, all these are composite supplies. And if the dominant supply is of an equipment, all other things will fall into the category of an equipment, and the rate applicable to the equipment will follow. Even though, I will give a very nice example to alter the discussion. If I go to a hospital and a stent is fixed in my heart, the cost of the stent may be more than the services value for the doctor. But still, the dominant supply will be of a doctor services, not of a stent. So it is not the value proposition which is there. There is the intent of supplying the goods here which will dominate the example you have given. So
you're probably referring to the definition of principal supply in the composite supply world, right?
But I can complicate that with a very simple example. Suppose I go to a grocery store.
You don't complicate with a simple example. Yeah.
I know, it's a very common.
Simply with a complicated example, the audience will love that better.
No, I'll give you a very nice example, then that we can go back home saying that it's not as simple as we think. You go to a grocery store, you buy bread and honey, presuming that bread attracts zero and honey attracts 28 for a moment. Now, which rate, suppose the grocery store issues one invoice for 100 rupees, 28 will apply or bread will apply? Obviously, you will say 28 will apply because bread and honey don't together. But you go to a restaurant and take bread and honey as a sandwich, still it's a service and it attracts 18%. So bread and honey can technically go together in a restaurant, but it cannot go together in a grocery shop. So that is the inference which I want. Mm-hmm.
Sir, before you answer, I have few questions, then you can give an answer, combined answer for it. Acha, you simple example. See, there are a couple of issues which comes to my mind when we look at composite supplies. Taking the same example which Amit has given, you supply an equipment, you do an installation, commissioning, and thereafter you do a training. Let's assume it's part of one contract. You have individual values also as part of the contract. Now, one fundamental question I always thought was, is this adopting composite supply an option to me or it is not an option to me? That's one thing. Can I still say that I don't want to treat it as a composite supply, I can treat it as an individual supply? That's one. We don't seem to have an answer to that.
Correct.
That's one. Number two, if you see the definition of composite supply, it has enough expressions which can give rise to litigations.
Naturally
it says
bundled.
It should be naturally bundled. It should be shared in conjunction with each other in the usual course of business. What is clear is the usual course of business. What do you mean by naturally bundled? A supply of an equipment with an installation, they may be naturally bundled. A training may not be naturally bundled. Then you look at in conjunction with each other. What do you mean by in conjunction? Do I do it at the same time? Do I do it slightly differently? Do I go by the contract? These are all issues that are thrown up by the definition. In fact, they wanted to solve a lot of issues by the definition, but the definition by itself is creating these issues, number one. Two, the point which I was thinking was, if you treat it as a composite supply, and then ultimately, as in this example, it becomes an immovable property, it becomes a works contract. The rate of tax is 18% for a works contract. Suppose your product attracts 28%. Can
and
they turn around to
that.
Say
yeah.
that the whole thing is a supply of composite supply of goods? Therefore, irrespective of that becomes an immovable property, we'll still treat it as a composite supply. I think these are all issues that are coming up to for consideration. I think we should all discuss that.
Yes, we should.
Let me also
yes,
go
sir.
So that we finally get to the revenues view.
See, at a jurisprudential level, 366-29A, they have failed to delete it from the Constitution. So Constitution calls this works contract, whereas your legislation, which is just a legislation, a child, calls this a composite contract. There's a huge disconnect. So it's a lapse, it's an omission, that's all. But it still has to be remedied. Because if there is a litigation tomorrow, whether revenue takes it or SSC takes it, whether a composite contract is a works contract or not, under the Constitution, it remains to be a works contract. So the GST law makes a distinction between movables and immovables. Works contract law doesn't make. An AMC contract is continuing to be only a works contract under the Constitution. But it is no longer a works contract under the GST. This is something which you should basically understand. But we need to move with the law. Therefore, how do you interpret a composite contract? Immovable bundled contracts become composite contracts. That's the first default rule. If it is immovable, then it goes into works contract scenario, identified construction, etc., etc., etc. So that's why Shivadas is saying, what is immovable test? Will it still goods, non-goods, excisable, non-excisable, all those theories, will it hold good? But still, the ground rule which you can possibly follow, what is this natural bundling? Natural bundling is one becoming inevitable to the other. The example given is a very good example by the government. You sell a goods, transportation is inevitable. Sell a goods, insurance is inevitable. Sell a goods, a banking transaction is inevitable. To sell a goods, you need to give some free supplies to package and enhance your sale. It's not a natural bundling. It's an artificial bundling. It goes to mixed supply. So when you read supply, you must be familiar with five terms under GST. Supply, inward supply, outward supply, continuous supply, mixed supply, and this composite supply.
And exam supply.
And exam supply. Seven. So, seven stars. So, natural means that. Now, to a straight answer to the question on an installation contract, let me give you some clarity there. What happens to an installation contract supply and installation, milestone payment separate, identified price separate, different parties executing subcontracting at different points of time separate, will it still be an unbundled contract? Do I have the option? You still have an option, but the underlying truth, or the underlying factor which binds the contract is time-tested judgments. At least we can dish out 15 Supreme Court judgments. In a turnkey contract, if you have a cross-fall breach clause saying supply contract failure, you will still catch me on installation. Installation contract failure, I'll still hold you responsible for supply. If you run a cross-fall breach clause, it's a bundled contract. If you don't have a cross-fall breach clause, it's an unbundled contract. So choice is with you. How you enter? See, contracting ability is still only with the contracting parties. Government cannot enforce how you should write a contract. But this law is well settled. So cross-fall breach clause decides the fate of a turnkey contract, whether it is composite or non-composite. Now to come to the heart, stent. See, now there are three variations. Earlier it was two variations, now there are three variations. Works contract relates to immovables. Composite contract relates to bundling of services and supplies in movables. Third is a pure service contract. He was saying, a stent may cost you 1.5 or 3 lakhs. If it is platinum coated, maybe more also. And the service charge of a doctor may be half of it. So value is not the criteria. Supreme Court in BSNL has said, the patient doesn't have the contracting ability to decide what he should buy. That is the test between a service contract and a works contract. You want a boiler, contracting parties will debate for times to say which type of a boiler you want it. Then execution of the boiler becomes a works contract or a composite contract. You go and admit to a doctor and says your stent has to be inserted. You don't negotiate with the doctor, give me the choices, let me see in the panel and let me choose which color, which size, which. You don't debate with the doctor. He decides, takes the call, what is well suited for you. So Supreme Court says, when contracting parties do not assimilate the intention to transfer goods, don't identify and transfer goods, then such a transaction, even if it involves goods, is simply a service contract. You come to me for an opinion, 100 page I type and then give it to you. Can they say it's a works contract because I'm passing my opinion in a paper? You don't come to buy paper with me. You come to buy only an opinion from me. So irrespective of the nature of the, so that's why in all the heart attack cases, we have survived the heart attacks in courts to say, it's not a works contract, it's a service contract. That's the difference you have to make in the, between the three, under the GST scenario also.
Over to you, sir.
We have lots to answer, sir.
Yeah, I know. Well, I'm wondering whether we should summarize the questions for sir to answer.
No, I think I'll take it on that, because Section 8 was introduced in the revised law. We are fully conscious of those three terms what we have used in the GST Act, be it composite supply, principal supply, or a mixed supply. Insofar as the composite supply is concerned, involving goods and goods, there's still possibility that something would be attracting higher rate of tax and a lower rate of tax, and what exactly is the dominant nature of supply. All those jurisprudential learnings what we have done in the last 60 years, we can't unlearn it, neither it is desirable. In a case involving the goods and services, we have tried to give a very simple illustration with regard to transportation of goods and insurance part of it, supply of goods with insurance. Now, one thing we need to keep it in mind. Now, as pure transaction involving the supply of goods or supply of services is a near rare situations in an actual real world. We have tried to put two, three things in a perspective when we define these terms. We said in case of a composite supply, we said a single price. Right? In case of a mixed supply, we did not use that phraseology. We use the same thing. We said,
Acha,
whatever it is. Okay. Mixed supply, we have is a separate price. It's single price is not there. By contradistinction, we have done that. Right? Now, what is naturally bundled? 66F, enough case laws have in the domain to for you to read. In a service to service, for example, a catering option available on onboard flight meal vis-a-vis the transportation of passengers by air, we know what exactly what we mean by that. Now, coming back to the erection installation commissioning part of it, if you look at the worst contract, the way the GST law has defined vis-a-vis what the VAT laws have defined, or for that matter, my service tax existing provision defined, we have consciously moved out to say only immovable property. I think that's where I think Mr. Venkatraman's clarification with regard to your contract will come into picture. If you have a liability inbuilt with regard to a service element from the goods part of it, or the goods element to the service part of it, obviously you intend it as a single supply. It's naturally bundle is what I'm going to say in the departmental perspective. Now, we need to look at this concept very, very carefully. We use the word principal supply. When we define the principal supply, we have contra distinct visit, which is not otherwise an ancillary supply. So we did not define what is an ancillary supply, we have defined principal supply. I would request all of you to read the guidance note on supply by the Royal Malaysian Customs on mixed supply and composite supply, where the tests of dependency with illustrations have been very carefully given, in fact. Now, if it is a single price consisting of more than one goods, whether they are supplied together, contractually, etc., or if there is actually a separate price but involving connectivity relationship, etc., or what is supplied in conjunction with each other, there is a certain amount on that, dependency, tie-up test, etc., etc. There are three concepts they have discussed at length. Not that when we drafted this mixed supply and composite supply, we kept the Malaysian GST law in mind. We basically approached the New Zealand GST law, and we have looked at that definition concept from the New Zealand GST because we had to address this. Because if you remember the draft law in the 2016 version, we set a composite supply, we did not use it anywhere in the law, and then we obviously understood that in the real world we need to provide a solution. My point is that we do have the dominant nature test well articulated right from Garen Dunkerley onwards. We have source law which is available to us. Obviously, those are going to be there in my mind when I'm going to administer this tax on the GST as well. State VAT officers are also well aware of this when they have done the works contract in the deeming sale concept. We look at that point in time. Now, given this mixed supply, composite supply, and also a principal supply definition, we feel that I think there are some things which are required to be fulfilled by before we do that. Let us look at a mixed supply, what PV has said as a very simple solution, bread and a jam. First and foremost, I would say, are they separately priced? If they are separately priced, obviously I will go into a concept not as a mixed supply. But certainly the option is available with the dealer. If he invoices you separately for the bread and he invoices separately the jam, so a tax official cannot say that no, they are having complementary functions. You need to price it together and then you have to charge it at the rate which is highest rate. Obviously the jam will have highest rate. So I'm not going to come with that. Let me be very clear on that point of it. So for a services plus services, I think the bundled service concept, what is naturally bundled? I think several case laws we have looked into that. What is not naturally not bundled also, we have discussed it in several contexts. The goods and services part of it, the dominant nature would decide that. But with regard to something becoming immovable, then what should be the nature of interpretation? Should that be subject to worse contract or should be subject to a composite supply treating as goods or services, whatever it is? At least in the drafting committee, we did not deliberate on that because we thought the worst contract will apply in a very limited manner. Coming back to Mr. Venkatraman's issue with regard to 366-29A subsisting and all, if you may recollect, the 2011 amendment proposed deletion, the 122nd amendment for some reasons or other did not take note of that, but that's history. We will see.
See, jam and bread, this is the distinction between a grocery shop and a restaurant. In a grocery shop, you buy the jam as a bottle and bread as a piece of food. There is no natural bundling there, even though both are supplied at the same point of time. Whereas in a restaurant, he gives you the same measure. The actual measure of consumption
you need in terms of jam and in terms of your bread, and therefore there it is a composite supply. That's the distinction. Possibly you can more than invoicing, you supply a jam bottle and a bread, you can't say it's a composite supply, because it may be disproportionate in their usage or the point of usage, whereas not so in the case of a restaurant.
Your thoughts? Let's go further. Yeah, you know. Now, the reason why, of course, we are debating this whole concept of bundled supply, just to get everybody on the same page, is it's only after you have understood what is the nature of this bundling, whether it is principally a supply of goods or principally a supply of service, or is it a deemed service under works contract, only then can you sit down and start applying the place of supply rules. So it's very crucial for us to appreciate the different types of bundling that happens in commercial world, and then start to distinguish or classify what is a mixed supply, what is a composite supply, and what is a works contract. There, the guiding light already provided to us is, use the definition of works contract judiciously. To the extent possible, use composite supply as the test. Identify naturally what is becoming the principal supply in a bundle. And if the principal supply happens to be a supply of goods, apply place of supply for goods. If the principal supply is a supply of services, apply place of supply for services. Valuation follows, taxing provisions follow, and so on.
That's one more. I don't know, it's a lacuna, but if Mr. Nagendra Kumar can throw some light. In composite supply, the term used is taxable supply. So if I have a non-taxable supply in a composite, what happens to that, I do not know. But in mixed supply, the taxable is not used. So is there a different intent in using the word taxable in composite and not using it in mixed? I can understand in mixed that you don't want a wrong mixture, that you exempt supplies become taxable at the highest rate. But in composite, the word taxable is used. Is it an overuse, or we have to dilute the interpretation when we apply it?
Because what happens, sir, is suppose there is an item which is exempt from tax, and then you also have a taxable service along with it. And then in the total price, the component of your exempt supply takes, assume, about 75% of the in terms of measure. Then how do we apply the rate? Do we apply the rate of tax relating to that service for the total one, or do we adopt a measuring tactics of, yes, I will apportion this value? Because some countries adopt these measures of apportioning the values and say we will tax it only for this. Is that possible?
That was not intent.
Okay.
That was clearly not intent.
In fact, if there is a supply involving a taxable element and a non-taxable element, be it goods or services, depending on the dominant nature, the supply nature will be construed. Right. So the exempt supply, to that extent which is consisting in that composite supply, will be ignored for the purpose of not taxing it as a component. We have not thought of attribution, apportionment at a transaction level. We have talked about only on the turnover level, not on a single transaction. The taxable word, because if you look at that, many times when we drafted, we used the word taxable person, taxable, and then we said a person. We have evolved over that. That taxable thing, when we did, no such thinking as to an exempt supply will be ignored if it is a composite supply.
I think that's the bottom line. In mixed supply, it is single pricing. So exempted supply will also form part of the bundle. Whereas in a composite contract, your exempted supplies may have an individual price. Therefore, they can directly minus it from its total extraction. And therefore, they have used the word taxable supply. That interpretation is certainly possible.
I think what we should do now, there are, of course, other questions also to come out, talking about head office, branch office transactions, what happens to supplies to Jammu and Kashmir, supplies from Jammu and Kashmir. But I will pause here, and I will open questions from the audience to ask the panelists if they have any doubts specifically, or to discuss any case studies. Anybody? Yes, sir.
My question, which is routine for deep in, sir. How the high sea seals are going to be taxed now? Any transaction happening between 12 to 200 nautical miles, one high sea sale, IGST. 0 to 12 nautical miles, CGST plus SGST, based on the state which is closer to that. And then once it comes to the customs port, then it is BCD plus IGST. Is this understanding correct?
Now, when we talk about IGST, what have we done? Basically, on the act of import, you levy the custom duty, right? That custom duty has got a basic duty component and also a countervailing measure, right? The import GST is deemed to be an IGST under the Constitution as well as in the IGST. Now, if the goods are not customs cleared, that means if it is not custom cleared, they are in what? They are in the journey of import. How will you levy a CGST, SGST, treating as an intrastate supply?
Because the definition of the state includes the 12 nautical miles from the state border.
As it?
It can't be three. Should I answer? It can't be three. It should be two. For this reason, beyond 12 nautical miles, law doesn't travel. Therefore, there is no IGST operating there. So,
but if you see the definition of India,
yeah,
it extends to 200.
No, in the East Coast it is, I mean, in West it is 200, in East, all that, 200 or 12, wherever it is. In your discharge port, I'll give you a live example. You do a high sea sale in your disport, it won't attract IGST. It'll simply be an import. You do a high sea sales within 200 or 12, then it attracts IGST.
That is what my question is, that Toyota Motors is shipping 100 cars. So one customer has approached and he wanted to buy 10 cars out of it. So this transaction is happening between 12 and 200 nautical miles.
It will be an IGST.
It is IGST?
Without a doubt.
Right. Then the second customer approaches and he says that I want to buy 20 cars out of the remaining 90.
Right.
Then it is happening between the 0 to 12, so it is going to be CGST plus SGST.
Because closer to the say, section 9.
Yeah.
All right.
So ultimately when the all the cars reach the port, entire 100 cars are to suffer BCD plus IGST.
But IGST in terms of only one single IGST, it is not multiple IGST. There can't be two IGST in the hands of the same taxable person.
Maybe sir, it is creditable, sir.
There is a lacuna at this point, at least in understanding, if not in law. Up to the 12 nautical miles, if the ship has crossed 12 nautical miles, and you do a high sea sales after it has crossed 12, that is closer to India. I'm not going in. There are two levies. If there's a high sea sales after crossing 12 nautical miles, there's one IGST because it's a state levy. That state which is closest to that territorial water, there is a sale from that state, a supply from that state, and that IGST gets triggered. Now, that IGST gets triggered because there's a sale from that. High sea sales has happened, that means new customer supply has happened. That IGST is not import related. That is independent of import related. It's like one state dealing with another state. There is another transaction which when the custom station enters, be it the warehouse or the custom, that transfer is neutral. But suppose it's cleared at the point of import, the custom station. There is one more IGST which gets triggered along with the BCD if there's a BCD applicable. Now, two IGSTs get visited or one IGST gets visited. Now, assuming that two are visited, whether the one is creditable against the other or not creditable against the other. I think that's the question. Correct, sir?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Because that is because of the amendment that was carried out in the latest law, saying that territory includes the plus. Because it was not there in the first two draft laws that came.
When the second transaction, it's off-the-cuff thinking, a little, it's a tentative view, okay? When the second transaction happens in terms of Section 9, it owes only a CGST and an SGST.
Correct.
It can't suffer an IGST there.
No, I'm not saying that. See, out of the 100 cars,
so
that first transaction of 10 cars
will suffer IGST.
Rakasarao,
yeah, but
don't take 100 cars, take a single car. It becomes easy to complete the transaction.
Single car, but there are two sales. There are two sales which are happening.
Same invoice or a bill of entry. That's what you're trying to say.
Yeah.
No, bill of entry comes later, sir. There will be three bill of entries in my example. 100 cars when the ship is sailing and it has entered within the 200 nautical miles, 10 cars are sold to customer A. So there is going to be an IGST. The same customer when it imports it into India, he has to pay again BCD plus IGST. So that earlier IGST what he has paid, he can take it as a offset here. Maybe that law may provide it. So there are two transactions. Another customer who is going to buy another 20 cars within the 0 to 12, he has to pay CGST plus SGST, but on import again, he will be subjected to BCD plus IGST, wherein for that IGST payment, he may take the credit of CGST, SGST, and he can offset it That can be the case.
Yeah.
Is it the
best
case?
Best time is Prakash Rao.
No, understood the question clearly.
Prakash Rao. Prakash Rao ji, keep awake in the midnight. Don't allow high sea sails after 12 nautical miles. Ensure that transfer
that
happens.
There also I have a question. So,
so we have a few more questions.
Yeah.
We have already run out of time. Can we take two more questions?
Only one point I want to say. The same transaction cannot be an interstate supply and intrastate supply. Very clear. Right. That's what I said. In so that dual status, the ought to be the tax has to be paid on import GST and the credit has to be taken for the second supply and set off. But this happened basically because of the amendment as Shivdas has said.
If so I remember practically correctly, it kills high sea sails after 12 nautical miles. It has to be. So that's why I told him to keep awake at the midnight and see whether the ship has crossed or not.
Sir, this is with respect to IGST Act, with respect to Bill to Ship 2, and in terms of the third party definition, having an example with respect to where there is a supply of goods to a pan-India entity where they have in all the states separate registrations, and the supply is happening from Karnataka to the respective states, but the bill to is to their head office in one of the state. So what is the place of supply in this regard?
Whom would you want to answer this question?
Sorry? No, anyone. He reversed the example. The supply happens to multiple places, but the invoice gets generated to the head office. We had dealt with that situation.
So in this case, as we had discussed earlier also, okay, the first supply is from the person who's supplying to the guy who's actually going to be purchasing. Okay. And from there, the shipment of the goods which is going to whichever location, you mentioned is going to multiple locations, those will be supplies going from that principal supplier into those multiple locations. So it's a dual supply. You will apply the principles of 101B and you will not go by 101A.
But these supplies are for the same entity. Same entity.
No, I thought you mentioned there were different entities.
No.
Same entity.
Pan India, I said pan India entity.
So that's where we started off with that discussion. The question that is coming up from a legal interpretation perspective is when you look at the meaning of the word supplier, recipient and person, are you going to be talking about them as separate legal entities? Or are you looking at them as distinct persons, therefore distinct registered locations? If you go by the principle of these people as separate persons, legal entities, then follow movement of goods in terms of identifying place of supply rules. Ignore the billing entity or the billing location rather. Okay. So ship from ship to will be your identifier for place of supply interpretation as opposed to bill from bill to. However, if you stand up and interpret the meaning of the word supplier, recipient and person to be registered locations, then you will have to respect the fact that the registered location which has first asked for the supply to take place and which is the location who's making the payment will be the primary supply. And then from that location, the broadcast of shipments going to whichever other locations is registered will be a secondary supply. Now at its core, the discussion is whether the meaning of the word supplier, recipient and person under 101A and 101B should be interpreted to mean legal entities or registered locations, which we are hoping that the government would probably clarify in the supplementary that sir was talking about right now. And we really look forward to that to come because this is really becoming a very basic interpretation issue. So would you want to have a thought on that?
Actually, when we drafted the place of supply provisions for the goods, as per the IGST committee report, the supply place of supply will follow the goods. Basically, in a triangulation, where a transaction happens between A to B, where the goods are being not shipped to B but to C, we said there is a deemed supply from B to C. Right? That is why in the ITC provisions, we said In order to enable the person B to take the credit without the goods actually being received, one of the conditions precedent for availing the input as credit, we said in a bill to ship to transaction, this can be permitted. That's what we have said. So place of supply in respect of goods will follow the goods. Even the supplier and the recipient are located in the same state. If the goods are being moving to a third jurisdiction, which is outside the state, still what nature of tax will have to be followed will be place of supply. The place of supply happens in the goods in which the delivery happens or the transportation terminates.
We can take one last quick question. Condition being it should be 30 seconds.
Which question or answer or both?
No, both.
Check.
Sir. As per the advisory, WCO advisory 14.4, we have a very clear identification that the last transaction only to be taken, the rest of the documents which is coming, it's a chain, international chain. This has been reiterated by CBC also in 32 of 2004, board circular. Would you like to connect that with this discussion, sir? So we can't do two times globally we can't do two times taxing the same transaction. No. Be it not.
No, there is a problem from an Indian context. His question is very. It took me time, but I've understood his question. He runs a status as an importer, and later a status because of Section 9 and other things as a CGST, SGST. Therefore, and he does a high C sales first, not when it's entering into Section 9. Then it becomes one IGST there. When he does it too, sir, let's resolve the conflict. Pay twice and take credit. You draw credit, huh? IGST to IGST. Huh? Then what PVA says, wake up at 12 o'clock and see when it crosses 12 nautical miles. The button will switch on itself. You have a problem then. You have a problem. Conceded. Conceded.
Well, I guess time's out. And
we should end the note with a problem. So we do it that way.
So I think we have done that. We have ended the note with a problem, something that needs to be solved. The whole conundrum of high sea sales comes back and bites us, no matter how much we try to avoid it. But thank you so much, respected panelists. This has been quite an engaging conversation, really. And the more we keep debating, the more we realize that this is not a one-time fix. I think this conversation of place of supply rules is deemed to continue now for the next 3 to 4 years for sure. And jurisprudence has to catch up with commercial prudence, as you rightfully observed, while the businesses actually align themselves to the new place of supply rules. Thank you so much, everybody. And thank you so much for being such a participative audience. Thank you so much.